Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
Coming off a big 5-4 win over the Oilers as we finally have a Battle of Alberta that means something again. As usual, I'm Dan alongside my co-host Matt. We're breaking down all the Flames news for you. How you doing, buddy?
Good. I don't know what it is about that one end of the rink in Rexall Place, but the Flames seem to have late-minute magic there.
It's nice to see a Battle of Alberta that means something again. I mean, you know, we're 1-1 with the Oilers now, and for so long it was just the Oilers came to town. You're like, yeah, well, it's a cheap and easy win. But I'm really glad to see it's meaning something, and we're seeing some good hockey being played again.
Yeah, it's not been a complete tire fire from the Oilers' side. And, you know, having Connor McDavid does make it a lot more fair. Like, the rest of the team is still not very good, but having a generational talent on your roster tends to wallpaper over any of the other flaws.
You know, with all the talk that we've heard, and I talked about this last week, but all the talk we hear of McDavid, I was shocked that he was on the ice with four other guys. I mean, the way they talk about McDavid, I thought they just play him.
Yeah, well, you gotta hype up the, you know, the next Crosby and all that, so.
Yeah, we'll see how he turns out.
Well, you know, it's just like when Crosby came in the league, it was like never ending. You know, the rest of the team didn't matter. It was only the Crosby show. And, like, when they'd interview other players, it was always questions about Crosby. It was quite ridiculous, so.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to play on that team.
Yeah, that's the same thing.
Well, Matt, let's start at the other side of the week and break down what we've seen. I think from the perspective that we recorded last on Tuesday the 27th, this is probably the best three-game stretch that we've seen so far. Let's break these down one at a time. On Wednesday night, the Flames, after their abysmal New York road trip, went to our nation's capital to play the Senators, and we snuck out of that one with a shootout loss. It was a 5-4 win by the Senators. It made its way all the way to a shootout there as we tied the game up. Sam Bennett got his first regular season goal in that game. What were your thoughts on the Senator game?
I thought that, extending back to last week, that the Flames started to put some of the positive things together, especially in the first 40 minutes, and we saw that in the Ottawa game as well. It's just that they kept getting bad goals given up by the goaltenders in all three of those games, and none of the goals that Ottawa scored were particularly good. It was a bit of a crazy game with all the Flames goals being strange bounces that just happened to go their way. So, there was a lot of positives that they could build on from their opening 40 minutes plus coming back a couple of times in the third period.
Yeah, and that was a really weird game too. I mean, just, you know, when the glass came out in that game and
twice.
It was just, I don't know, it was a weird game, and Calgary didn't look good, but I think that there was a lot that broke up their momentum in that game.
No. Well, how would you say, based on last year, that was a disappointing effort, but based on this season, that was probably their best effort to date. It is what it is, though.
One of the things that I saw in that game is I thought that Calgary, for once, seemed to have the right positioning. Their guys seemed to be in the right places, challenging the right checks, making the right plays, angling guys off to the boards. They weren't challenging enough. Like, they had the right positioning. They were where they needed to be, but they just weren't challenging enough and winning the battles.
No, and
especially in front of their own net.
Yeah, and like if you look at the goal that Bobby Ryan scored in the abbreviated end of the second period, the defenseman could have just pushed him out and didn't. Then the puck goes in the net. The Turris goal, it was very much the same thing where the puck's sitting in front of the net and nobody takes the body. Instead, the puck's lying there for like 3 or 4 seconds before Turris is able to grab it and then fire it in.
Yeah, it's kind of what I mean. Like the Ryan goal, like you said, the player was there. They just didn't, you know, they didn't finish the check. They didn't, you know, put in the effort, I guess, that they needed to, you know, to win the game.
Mm-hmm. And that's part of the problem that the Flames have had all season. They're getting partially good efforts. It's just all the little attentions to detail, and then having the problem with the goaltenders allowing goals that they really shouldn't. Like, everything's just kind of been conspiring this past month to cause the Flames to not be on the winning side of things.
Speaking of the goalies, that game was sort of interesting in that respect too, because in the end of the third period, we saw Jonas Hiller go down, and he is now out injured because of that. We saw him go down, and with about 12 minutes left, Joni Ordio came into the game to finish off the game. He played 12 minutes and 40 seconds, but just another weird thing to go with a weird game was losing the starting goalie.
Yeah, and there was nothing about that particular game that made any sense, really. From strange bounces, injuries to goalies. It's one of those that you just kind of like, okay, that happened, carry on. On to the next one.
So, on to the next one then. Before we move to the next one, we got to talk about what happened with the goaltending situation going forward chronologically. So Hiller went down, they put Ordio in. I knew right away, as soon as I saw the trainers out there, this was bad. And it came out after the game that Hiller's going to be out for at least a week.
Yeah, and realistically, I don't see it being just a week. From how he was limping off to the dressing room, you could tell that that's probably going to be more of a 2 to 3 week injury.
Hiller's also not known as being an Iron Man either.
No.
There's a guy who tends to get hurt, and when he gets hurt, it tends to stick around for a while.
Yeah. And that's one of the good things about having three goalies, is that with the Hiller injury, we do have somebody that can go in.
Well, I think that was always the thing. When the Flames signed Hiller as a UFA, I think they knew, okay, you know, this guy is coming off a lot of injury time. We need to have somebody capable to be there in case.
Yeah. And thankfully, last year, by and large, he wasn't hurt much. It's one of those things. It happens. And now we got the ratio pairing of Ramo and Ordio.
Yeah, well, let's talk about that. So Ordio came in to play the last 12 minutes. And obviously, Ordio then going forward was the only healthy Flames goalie. So what did the Flames have to do? They had to make a call back to Stockton and go, hey, Ramo, I hope you haven't got too comfortable. You're coming back to Calgary. Just days after he got reassigned to the AHL, he's back in Calgary and back wearing a Calgary Flames jersey.
Yeah, 20 minutes of AHL action was more than enough for Ramo.
So he's got to be happy about that one.
Yeah, I'm sure he's pleased to be back here, and he didn't look too bad in the Oilers game.
No. Before we get to the Oilers game, though, we got to go through the Canadien. This was a game that I had predicted the Flames might have been able to win, and it was just a slaughter. We were tied up halfway through the second period, and as we usually see with the Flames, is in the last half of the second and the third, as has happened pretty much every other game this season, it got away from us, and the Canadien went out and scored 4 goals in a row to make it a 6-2 final. Thoughts on this one?
It was a great first 35-ish minutes, 30-35 minutes. The Flames were right there. Punch for punch, everything was going good. That Mason Raymond failed chance in the first period was an absolute disaster, and then Montreal scored right after. Honestly, if I was the coach, he wouldn't have seen the ice again for the rest of the game after that, but that's just me. And then in the second period, Ordio surrenders 3 goals on the first 5 shots, and none of them were particularly dangerous. So, you know, that's the story of the entire season thus far. Really bad goaltending has, you can't come back. If you're surrendering goals, like, it's one thing, like, if you're getting a breakaway and you let it in, okay, well, that makes sense because it's a breakaway. But weak wrist shots like the ones that Dale Weiss scored his first two on, give me a break. Those, any goaltender should be able to stop those. And instead, they're in the back of the net and it deflates the entire team.
And I don't think we can pin it squarely on the goalie either. I thought, especially in that Montreal game, we had really bad defense as well.
Oh, true. I'm not saying it was just Ordeo, but...
I mean, especially in the second period of the Montreal game, we had way too many giveaways in our own end. And the reason that Montreal had so many goals and had so much possession is that we were giving them the puck inside our own blue line.
Yeah, and it, like, you can't let a guy like Smith Pelly to be standing right in front of the net at wide open and not covering the passing lane and not covering him. So it's one of those things where you're getting the combination of goalies not making any good saves and the defense playing really poorly.
After the Juris goal, Juris's first goal of the year with that came in the second period, when we tied it 2-2, I thought, okay, we might have a game here. Like, up to that point, both teams were pretty much even, I thought, at that point. Maybe Montreal was getting better play in our end than we were getting in their end, but I thought, okay, we can do this. And then we scored, and I still thought we could do it. But after the Smith-Pelly goal, I thought, you know what, we're starting to see this team just coming unraveled. And
I know, and like when it went to the third period and we got that power play chance early, I was like, if the Flames can score, they might actually have a chance. And then Paul Byron gets a breakaway and does the thing that he failed to do all of last season, and that was score a goal.
And he's got one in that game, and that was his first, so who knows how many more he'll get. But
He did on his next game. He actually got another breakaway and scored again against Winnipeg. So
I think that was the sort of the shot to the heart, if you will, was that the goal that I thought really put the game out of reach was scored by Paul Byron.
Yeah, and the Flames, right after that, they just stopped playing entirely and mailed it in. Like, that was probably the most pathetic hockey by the Flames I've seen since the, like, March 2013, 2014.
Yeah, it was a terrible third period.
Yeah, that was, like, wow, just, you know, fast forward the clock so we can get out of here bad.
And, you know, we have to give Hartley credit. He gave Ordeo the start. You know, he could have just said, we're calling up Ramo and Ramo's going in, but he gave Ordeo the start. Not a great game for Ordeo. Ordeo's 0-2-1 now on the season. But, you know, it was the start that Ordeo needed. And if this guy is the goalie of the future, as the Flames keep saying he is, you have to play him, right? You just got to give him minutes in the net.
Yeah, and this was the thing that I think was the reason why the Flames did re-sign Ramo, was in case Ordeo played really poorly. And he didn't in the preseason, so it looked like, oh, that's a, you know, we've created a three-headed monster. But this is the kind of goaltending from Ordeo that we saw in Abbott's Adirondack last year, and like where he was giving up 5-6 goals every game.
Well, and Ordeo has a history of not starting well, and I even expressed this concern coming into this season that if he's not strong at the beginning of the season, somebody's going to have to carry the load for him. But at the same time, if he's not playing, he's not going to be able to work through that funk. So, you know, in some ways, you're damned if you do, damned if you don't.
I know, and it's one of those situations that if he continues to play poorly, do you just say, well, thanks for coming out, and we're going to go with Gillies next year instead, or, you know, sign some or trade for another goaltender instead?
Yeah, I don't know if I would have that discussion yet. I think
we're still
early in the season, and I want to give him time to show us what we saw from him last year.
Oh, for sure. It's just that, like everybody, the writing's on the wall. If you're not going to perform, there are other guys out there that we can bring in to do the job. So he really does need to, like, it when he does get his next start, because I know Ramo's playing tomorrow against Colorado, the next opportunity he gets, he needs to have a really good game and start reestablishing himself as the go-to guy.
Yeah, but at the same time, Hartley has to trust him enough to put him in net so he can't establish himself that way.
Oh, for sure.
So let's I'd say leave that Montreal game behind. That was a terrible game. I don't want to think about it anymore. The next night, Halloween night, the Flames traveled up to Edmonton, and
Oilers decided to dress as pumpkins for the festivities.
That's right. They wore those terrible orange jerseys that I guess was suitable for Halloween, but I don't know. By the end of the 3 hours, my eyes were hurting watching those jerseys on TV.
Oh, I know. Just spectacularly terrible jerseys to go with a spectacularly terrible team.
I don't know. At least they're not our jerseys. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah.
You know, and I think, and you and I talked about this off the air last week, but I think what the Predators have done with their yellow jersey, I've warmed up to. I think that at first I was really hesitant about the yellow that the Predators are wearing, but I think that they've done some good things with it and they've balanced it. But the Oilers, I don't know, that orange is terrible.
Well, it wouldn't be so bad if it wasn't for the blue. It's just too much of one and not enough of the other, or not enough of the one. You know what I mean?
Yeah, they don't have a lot of other colors to go to, though. I mean, you're not going to put white on the back of that jersey for numbers.
I know. It's just a mess.
You know, I mean, what have they got? They got white, orange, and blue. You have to go with the blue, but there's just too many blue stripes on it. So
yeah, the whole thing's just ugly.
Yeah, I don't know. At least not our jersey. That's all I can say.
Yeah.
But you know what I noticed, though, is their home and away jerseys, the pants have an orange stripe going down them, but on the orange jersey, they have just a blue shell that goes over the pants.
I didn't notice that.
Yeah, it's like they just put a shell on it just to cover the stripe, and I'm going, that's a lot of work for one jersey.
Yeah.
You know, at least with the Flames, their pants are the same on the third jersey, even though it bothers me because the lines don't match up. For those that don't know, if you take a look at the Flames stripes on the side of the home and away jersey, the lines, the yellow and black lines line up with the yellow and black lines on the pants. And when they're lined up, they look good. It looks terrible on the third jersey. I've said maybe we should wear just a black shell there, but I don't know. It's probably a lot more work to carry around extra shells for your pants. Maybe that's why they're wearing them at home.
Yeah.
But anyway, enough about the Oilers. We went into this game. I don't know about you. I was not optimistic going into this one. After a 6-2 spanking from Montreal, I was expecting that the terrible play would carry over.
I was somewhat hopeful that after getting, like, how the game ended in Montreal, that game, I think it left a really bad taste in our mouth, and, like, especially how the last game against the Oilers went, I think it was, like, okay, enough, and let's play a lot better, and none of this BS.
And then we went into that game in Edmonton, and I thought probably the best 60-minute effort we've seen all year from the Flames. This team, to me, looked not quite as good as last year's team, but they're getting up there to where they were last year. The Flames started off early. We had Brandon Bolig and Michael Frolik both score their first goals of the year in the first period. Taylor Hall got one as well, and then Frolik came back with his second goal of the year. And I don't know about you, but this Frolik that we saw, this is what I expected from Frolik.
Yeah, and he was good, very good in that game.
He's been almost invisible in some other games, but this
is
what I
was
expecting.
Well, how would you say Frolik has always been somewhat inconsistent with the offense, but not with the effort? And in the 12 games he's played, the effort's been there. It's just the bounces weren't necessarily going his way. And, like, he had 5 assists in the first 11 games. It just, now it seemed like once he broke through and actually scored a goal, things really started going his way after that.
And we opened the floodgate of Michael Frolik in that game, and Frolik ended up getting his first professional hat trick, his first NHL hat trick, which, It's weird to think a guy who's been around the league as long as he has hasn't had a hat trick. I found that kind of weird.
Yeah, especially for how many points he gets in a season, you would figure that
he's
somewhere.
Yeah, he's not like a fourth line guy.
Yeah.
So the goals in that game, Bolig scored his first, Frolik scored his first, Frolik scored his first and second in the first. TJ Brody got his first goal in the second period, and then Michael Frolik came back to get the game winner, his third of the season, in the third period. And I don't know about you, but after Edmonton tied it, after the Draisaitl goal, I thought, ah, crap, we're going overtime. And I, at that point, with Edmonton having two goals in the third, I thought they were starting to take the pressure to Calgary, and I wasn't confident that we could do it in overtime.
No, and especially when you got a guy like McDavid on 3-on-3, yeah, that's not fun. So
no, and I mean, if we had the sort of the advantage, if you will, or if we had, you know, everything going our way, maybe. But at that point, Edmonton looked like they were starting to pound us in the third, and I just thought, crap, Calgary's going to fizzle out in the 3-on-3.
Yeah, well, anytime you have a 2-goal lead and then surrender it, the momentum's not going your way. And
no, and even if we could have held them off in the 3-on-3, they've got better shooters than we do.
Yeah, exactly. And I wasn't altogether confident either, but thankfully the puck found the, like, 3-inch gap in Talbot's pad between his leg and the post and trickled in. Just bizarre goals in the last minute. Like, you remember that David Moss goal against Habby Boulin where, like, Habby Boulin fanned on it and Moss was like, oh, thanks, and poked it in?
Sort of, yeah.
It was like 5, 6, 7 years ago, but...
Sort of, just, vaguely.
Yeah, just lots of really odd goals in Rexall place in the last few minutes.
But, you know, I'll take the win however I can get it. And,
oh, for sure.
You know, good goal, bad goal, weird goal, whatever. But with 18 seconds left, not even 8 seconds left, the Flames scored to get the win. And I think that's a win that we needed. And I think just having that Michael Frolik goal as late as we did to give us that energy back, I would not be surprised if we look back at this and say this goal could be the turning point for this team.
Yeah. It's one of those things that when everything seems to be screwing up for you, you just need a bit of good luck to get things to start going the other way. And that fluky goal, because really it was a bit of a fluke, that could very well be the spark. And especially with the Flames' next opponent being Colorado, who has the same amount of points thus far this season as the Flames, that might be a good game in order to start getting the ball rolling and some momentum. Because if they pick up 2 points in that one, all of a sudden, now you're on a bit of a winning streak, and now we can start taking it to teams instead of, oh, what's going to screw up now?
Yeah, I think that might give the Flames... I mean, momentum is big in hockey, and I think that might give the Flames the momentum and the confidence they need going forward.
Oh, for sure. And it's one of those things that now we're in a new month, everything that happened. The Flames are only 5 points out of a playoff spot after being that terrible. So, it's not optimal, but everything that could have went wrong in October did. So, now we've got a little bit of momentum. Now, you got
time
a fresh
to build
page. Yeah, let's build on it. And you've got an easier opponent against Colorado. Philadelphia's struggling as well. So you could all of a sudden start turning this around and go on a bit of a winning streak. And if you start winning 3 or 4 games, now you're back right back into the playoff picture. And it's not, like, despite everything that happened, you're not screwed, basically, if you can start getting things to go correctly.
In the Ottawa game, Joni Ordio allowed 6 goals on 31 shots. In the Edmonton game, Ramo turned aside 19 of the 23 that he faced to pick up his first win of the season. What did you think about Ramo's performance in that Edmonton game?
I thought he was actually pretty good. If you look at how the goals went in, there wasn't any that you could say definitively, oh, he messed up. Each of the goals that they scored was a legitimately good goal. And that happens sometimes. You know, a goalie can do everything and still surrender four or five. It doesn't help considering the fact that how the season's gone, but
when I looked at it, I thought Ramo was really showing that he wants to show that he belongs here in the NHL. I think maybe
I agree.
Getting sent down to the AHL and being waived lit a fire under his butt. And as we've talked about in the past, I always think Ramo does better under pressure. And I thought maybe we were seeing that from him again. Like you said, none of those were really his fault. And I thought for the most part, Ramo looked good in that game. And I think maybe it's the best single goalie performance we've had all year.
Yeah, which is somewhat scary to think that, you know, a four goal against performance is the best one.
Yeah, but some of that was the defense's fault.
Oh, yeah, for sure. It's just, you know.
But you're right. I mean, a guy who's got a .826 for save percentage, and that's his best outing of the year, that is sort of worrying.
Yeah.
But we've got that week done. Like you said, we're done the month of October, the first 12 games. And,
yeah, and like everything that did go wrong did, and it could go wrong did. So if that's the Flames version of the 8-game losing streak from last year, like if you can put that aside and like carry on and not continue to struggle like that through the month of November and start getting some wins and positivity around the team, then things will start looking up quickly. It's just
after that Edmonton game, it feels like they're starting to put the pieces together. That felt like the closest thing to Calgary Flames hockey we've seen yet this year. And, you know, if they can keep that momentum running from what we saw in the Edmonton performance, I think that we're going to see this team on an upswing.
Oh, for sure. And coincidentally, the Flames start playing the best hockey of their season once TJ Brody returns.
Not surprising, though. I mean, you know, Brody was very much an integral part of the team last year. The chemistry that he had with the captain was a big part of what made our blue line, so I'm not surprised that they're doing better bringing Brody back in the lineup.
Oh, for sure. He's been fairly spectacular, especially in the Edmonton game. He looked a little off still in the Ottawa game, probably rushing back from injury a bit, but especially in the Edmonton game, he was fantastic.
Talking about guys that are looking well or looking good like Brody, I agree that he doesn't look like a guy who was injured. I mean, yeah, he's got some rust on him, but he really hasn't played, so he's about where I expect him to be. But a guy that I'm still disappointed by, and we talked about this a little bit last week, is Michael Backlund. Looking at his faceoff percentage this past week, as we talked about last week, he's a centerman. And in the Ottawa game, he won only 47% of his draws. In the Montreal game, he won 43%. And in the Edmonton game, he won 29% of his draws. Like, to be the only centerman who's consistently had less than 50% wins, that's worrying.
Yeah, and it's one of those things that we saw him get demoted to the fourth line, I do believe, in the Montreal game. And in the Edmonton game, he needs to figure out how to play better. And the thing is that Backlund is a good player. He's just really fighting the puck for whatever reason, and nothing seems to be going right for him. If he can start getting into some good habits, I think everything will start going better for him. But right now, his demotion is definitely justified.
Do you think that we have Backlund playing with the right line mates?
I honestly think that regardless of who his line mates were, he would have been struggling because he's not doing the things that he normally does to make himself successful. Like, even his defensive positioning has been a little off as well. So, it seems like he just, everything's not quite clicking for him. And if he can get in those good habits, things will turn around really quickly. It's just, like, he's a lot better of a player than what he has been in this month. But you could pretty much say that about every single player on the Flames.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. But he's the only centerman who, I mean, we didn't have a great week for faceoffs as it was, but he's the only guy who consistently is showing us that he's not able to win the faceoffs. And if that's happening, we might need to convert him to wing or have somebody else take the draws for him. But we can't have a guy who's playing center consistently winning less than 50% of his draws.
Yeah, and
especially a guy who gets time on the penalty kill.
Yeah, and with the Flames having, I think, like 6, 7, 8 centers on the team at any given point, that you could start to, like, say if Colborne's on his line, you could just have him take the draws, or Juris, or whomever, really. There's other options, if need be.
And like you said, the whole team is struggling right now, so we got to give them some time to turn it around and see what happens there. But, I mean, we're seeing even guys like, you know, Hudler, Monahan, Russell, all the guys we need to be seeing good performances from, not giving us those performances. And if you look at why the team is struggling, as much as we place a lot of that on the goalies and the defensemen, nobody on this team is playing the way they need to be. No one is showing us, you know, the effort that we saw from them last year. And I think the struggles you got to look at the entire lineup. Every guy who's worn a Flaming C this year hasn't given us what we've needed.
Yeah. Like, you look at a guy like Kudler, and he's getting a lot of points, but the attention to details in his game have been a little suspect at times. Like, the Dreisaitl goal that tied the game in Edmonton on Saturday, the Flames rushed into the zone, and Hudler had the puck behind the net, and he passed it back, but there was absolutely nobody there in a Flames jersey, and then the puck goes back the other way, a 3-on-2, and bang, it's in the net. His passing lately has been off. Like, that's the most egregious example, but there have been quite a few times in the last couple of weeks where, like, he's just making really poor decisions with the puck, and it leads to odd man rushes back the other way, and he just needs to tighten that up.
Yeah, well, I think everyone has something to tighten up, but I think that we're at a point where we're starting to see them coming around to that.
True.
And I think we'll see a lot better performance coming in November right now.
Yeah, it's one of those things that I'm sure a lot of the players are just basically wanting to put October in the category of that really didn't happen, we're just starting over, and who cares? You know, everything's equal in our minds, let's just carry on.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Well, looking back at October before we go too far in November and finishing analyzing this month, I found a new site today that I thought some of our fans might like. It's called War on Ice, and the URL is www.war-on-ice.com. And you can go to any game that's been played or in progress on this site and look at some really interesting stats that you don't usually see from other sites. You can see things like shot attempts. They predict the win probabilities. You can even see shots by individual players from different stats, like based on where they shot from. So was this a dangerous shot? Was this not a dangerous shot? It's sort of a really neat breakdown. It's sort of there's so many people that want to get into advanced stats today, and it's an interesting place to do that and sort of start figuring some of that out. Like, they talk about the high danger scoring chances, the individual scoring chances, the total shot attempts of every player. So if that's the kind of thing you're into, definitely check this site out. But Ryan Pike over at Flames Nation, a friend of the show, he did a really interesting article on Flames Nation where he looked at the different scoring chances, low danger, medium danger, and high danger, based on where they were on the ice. We'll link it in the show notes so you can look at the graph yourself. But looking at the type of shots, not just the amount of shots, but the type of shots all our goalies have taken and where they've taken them from this season, and some interesting analysis on the goaltenders. And I won't read his whole article. If anyone wants to read it, they can go do that. But pretty much summing up each goalie, Matt, I'll go through them all, and then let me know if you think this jives with your thoughts on each goalie. Jonas Hiller, the quality of shots he's faced so far this year is up a little bit from last season, all things considered, as far as the high danger, medium danger, and low danger. He's faced fewer shots per minute, or sorry, fewer shots per 60 minutes than did a year ago. So he's getting less shots per game, but his save percentage has dropped about 5% from where it was last year. So essentially he's getting better shots, but letting more of them in.
I can't argue with that.
And again, a lot of that's, I think, the defense's problem for allowing some of the shots to come out of the high danger zone area.
Yeah.
For Kari Ramo, Ramo's facing fewer, easier shots than Hiller does, but has allowed more goals more frequently.
And a lot of that has to do with some of the fluky goals that he's been surrendering, whether it's, you know, like that Weidman goal where he put it in his own net, or random deflections off of people's legs and that kind of thing.
Yeah, even the Bufflin shot earlier in the season, you remember when he pulled off the deke on Weidman?
Yeah, it just, there have been a lot of weird goals that aren't necessarily 100% Ramo's fault that have gone in, and from strange spots on the ice. So it does make sense that his numbers would be a little bit off because of that.
And then looking at Ordio, I mean, a lot of people, you know, remember Ordio as having great games here last year. Apparently he's facing more shots per game than he did last year so far. I know Ordio hasn't played many games, but and they're about as dangerous as he faced last year, and he's been about as good at stopping them as he was last year. So Ordio is probably the one that has, you know, as much as we talked about how he needs to play more, he's as far as this article says, he's pretty much the guy who's continued his consistency from last year.
Well, you also have to remember that he only played, I think, 5 or 6 games last year, and he was in that last game of the season against Winnipeg when the coaching staff really didn't care. So
yeah, and I mean, he was in the net at that point by the time the Flames were in full stride.
Yeah.
He wasn't the guy that was here battling it out, you know, during the 8-game losing streak and during some of the tough times the Flames had.
True.
So it was easy for him to come in and look good when he had, you know, the full force of the playoff-ready Calgary Flames in front of him.
Yeah.
But I'm not surprised by that. Just thought it was kind of interesting to point out. Like I said, we'll link in the show notes at firesidechat.ca the article that Ryan wrote, and you can go through and see some of those stats if you're interested in that. But I thought it's kind of neat to look at the quality of shot, not just the number of shots that's going on each goalie and from where. Well, that's October in the books. We've looked at October. We've talked about the woes of October, probably the worst month that hopefully we're going to have for this team. And traditionally, October is a bad month for the Flames, so I'm not saying that it's justified the poor month they've had, but not surprising, I guess. And if we look ahead to November, we actually have an interesting month here. We have more games, a lot more games on the road than we do at home. We have some Eastern Conference games. We have a lot of Eastern Conference teams. We're going to play the Flyers, the Penguins, the Panthers, the Lightning, the Capitals. But really, it's going to be a lot of road games. Matt, what do you think the Flames are going to have to do coming off the week that we just saw in order to be successful in November?
Focus on the details. It's the small, simple plays. Instead of making high-risk passes or high-risk shots where if it doesn't go perfectly, it's going to be a turnover and the puck's going back the other way, just keeping it simple, driving the net, instead of, like, you remember that play where Stajan was in on the 2-on-1 and he dropped it back to the third guy coming in and it caught everybody off guard and the play died. Just do the simple things instead of trying to be overly creative like that. And, like, even on the defensive side, just making sure that you're where you need to be at all times. And if the Flames can do that, then they'll be more successful just because of the amount of talent that is in the organization.
Yeah, to me, I think there's three major things they need to be doing right now. One is playing smarter hockey. Like you said, they need to do the little things right, but I think even looking at the defensive effort they put in is just really knowing where they are and what they're supposed to be doing at any given time, all five guys in the ice. We don't want anyone standing around. We don't want anyone missing checks. Like, everybody just needs to be where they need to be and knowing what they need to be doing. I think the other one we need to do is we need to start having guys, and I was kind of looking back at last season, some of the things that we said were the keys for last season. I think we need some guys to start establishing their role on this team. I think so far we've had a lot of guys who have been trying to break out and be the offensive star or, you know, play a different role. And I really think we need to have everybody start to figure out what it is they're supposed to be doing and what their role is. If you're the playmaker or the sniper or where you're going to be at. And some of that's going to come with just having, good, consistent lines. And thirdly, I think they just need to start playing smart hockey. You know, they need to go out there and do the little things, not overcomplicate it, but play simple, smart hockey. Just, you know, move the puck forward. Don't let yourself get beat. And if you look at their game last year, the Flames had a very simple game, but it was a very smart game that worked.
Yeah, I was listening to the radio again after the Montreal game, and Martin Gélinas was being interviewed on the Fan 960, and he was saying, like, what one of the things that the players need to do is make sure that they're either even or a plus one or better in each game. And, like, you're lining up against their guy, you have to beat him. You can't control what everybody on the team's doing, but you just have to beat that one guy. And that's what the Flames need to do, is more dedication to just being better than the guy that they're facing. Like, if the goalie lets in a bad goal, oh well, you can't do anything about that. You still have to do your job.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that's the big thing too, is having everyone knowing what that job is. And when I look at last year, I think that's one of the things that made us successful, was everybody seemed to know exactly what their job was when they were on the ice.
Yeah. You know, I can agree with that.
And we didn't have guys like Bolig trying to go out there and be the sniper, or even guys like Juris, who, you know, was scoring goals. He knew exactly what his job was and how he had to play when he was out there. And I think we're seeing a lot of guys this year who don't seem to know what their role is. And I think that's going to help a lot once we get these guys established into, you know, this is the type of player we need you to be.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm hoping that 12 games now, I mean, we haven't changed the lineup that much, but even a guy like Dougie Hamilton, I think, is, you know, starting to come into his own and figuring out the type of player we need him to be here.
Exactly. And everything has gone wrong, and that's why it's been as bad of a start as it has been. Because, like, usually some players are get off to poor starts, regardless of what team you're talking about. And it does take a while to, especially with all the new acquisitions that teams have, of trying to fit the roster. It's just, like, now it's, okay, we're through a dozen games, now this needs to be where, you know, what this team is moving forward.
If the Flames continue to slump, Matt, as we go into November, if we, you know, go into the Colorado game, the Flyers game, you know, the first couple games we're still seeing a slump, and they're looking to change something. I've heard some fans who've said, you know what, it's time to give Jon Gillies a shot in net. What are your thoughts on that?
Absolutely not. Honestly, I would rather give Kent Simpson the job than Gillies. Gillies needs to learn how to play at the professional level, and he's basically, I do believe he started every single game for Stockton, and he pretty much needs to play at most of the games down there. Yes, the Flames are struggling, but he's the goalie of the future, in my opinion, and you can't have him getting rushed to the NHL, because that might, like, if he comes in and gets shelled because the Flames defense is playing poorly, that's gonna hurt his confidence, and then he's gonna have a hard time adjusting, and it might end up screwing him up long term, where it might even limit his eventual potential. So yeah, you don't do that.
To be honest, Gillies hasn't looked all that good in the AHL either. I mean, he's still trying to figure out the professional level, and if he can't even, I would say, get his game the way we need it in the AHL, what's to say that he's going to do well at the NHL level?
Yeah.
He hasn't been a shining star in all the games he's played at the AHL level.
Well, he's only really struggled in the two of the first four games. The other ones he got shutouts, but the last two, especially against San Diego, he actually played really well. So, you know, it's one of those things. He needs to have his ups and downs and figure out how to play at the AHL level. And you can't, it'll mess up his whole game if you bounce him between the NHL and the AHL. It's one of those things, like, if he was, say, like, the season progresses and, like, he's just tearing the AHL up and the Flames are basically out of it in February, March, then maybe you bring him up for a handful of games just to, hey, this is what the NHL's like. Now you can, you know, you're doing great in the AHL. Now you can see what the NHL's like, so you can work on that in the off season and come back and try and steal a job next year.
See, to me, I think Ordeo is the young guy that we have put, right or wrong, the Flames have put the stake in the sand and said, this is our goalie of the future right now. You know, he's number three, but he's the young guy who we're putting faith in, so we left him in the NHL roster. And I think if you start bringing Gillies in and you play Gillies, you're sort of undermining your whole goaltending system.
Yeah, I agree with that.
And I think that you have to give, especially a guy like Ordeo, who up before this season has really done no wrong at the NHL level. Like, if you look, I can't look back and really think of a game where Ordeo was terrible. He's earned, I think, a chance to at least get the look. And until you've looked at Ordeo and said, either we're going to go forward with this kid or we're not. Because if you look, Hiller and Ramo are out of here at the end of this season. I doubt either one comes back. You're probably not going to play an Ordeo Gillies pair next year, unless you think that Ordeo is backup material. But right now we're projecting both those guys to probably be starters. So I think you really have to give Ordeo the chance to shine this year before you bring up yet another kid and sort of undermine that whole process.
Yeah, and realistically, I would expect Ordeo to probably play at least 30 games in the NHL this season, if not more, and then probably more like 50 next year.
Yeah, but even then, I don't think you'd have an Ordeo-Gillies pairing next year. I think they'll be bringing in an NHL veteran to back him up.
Yeah, like, you might even, like, say, like, the Flames rebound, the goaltending rebounds, and Ramo plays well. I could see the Flames bringing him back on a 1 year.
Yeah, I don't know if he's going to want to come back.
You know what I mean.
Yeah.
Like, whatever permutation works, whether it's going outside and acquiring, like, the next Cam Talbot or whatever, you know what I mean.
Yeah, and I just, you know, I think that, yes, Gillies is probably the guy for the future, but as you said, I think the best place for him right now is at the AHL level. Even if we're tanking, I wouldn't bring him up, because I don't think you want to really expose him on a bad team. Maybe if we're in the playoffs and we're locked up, you bring him in the last 10 games of the year. But I think that right now his focus needs to be playing at the AHL level and learning the Flames system and working with, you know, Hushka and the coaches down there. And I would not consider right now bringing him up. I don't think that that's going to solve anything. You know, it's just
No. It's
bringing him up to make a change. But if we're slumping, you're trying to solve things. I don't think that in any way bringing Jon Gillies in solves your problems. So now we send him back and we got to rely on the same three guys. Really,
Yeah. You
got to pick one of our guys and you need to, you know, ride them.
Yeah. Like, if you really absolutely wanted to throw somebody in there, I would go with Kent Simpson just because if he does screw up, you know, so are all the other guys. And it's
but
not
again,
really...
I think even that undermines things even more. Like, I think you just got to keep riding your two, whoever it's going to be. If it's going to be Ramo or Ordeo, you know, Simpson is not going to go out there and play a better game than Ramo.
No.
And if he does, we're not going to keep him in the NHL.
I know. It's one of those situations that the players just need to figure it out on their own and sort out their crap and get it done.
Yeah, I think you just got to keep riding whichever two the coaches decide to go with and get those guys functional. I don't think bringing in a goalie from the AHL is going to solve anything because you're not going to keep Simpson up here all year if he does well in two games and send Ordeo down.
No, of course not. And that's why the solutions, to use the cliche, are in the room. And, you know, if they don't figure it out, well, the Flames are going to be a lottery team and oh well. And that's that.
Which, as we talked about last year, I mean, that was the expectation last year. And, you know, maybe we've sort of missed that year and maybe that's where we need to be.
Yeah. How would you say, in a rebuild, there's never negatives. If you have a great season like we did last year, that's awesome. If you struggle and are a bottom five, bottom ten team.
I wouldn't say there's never negatives. As long as you can turn around after being a bottom five. You know, like Edmonton and be in that position for 5 years in a row.
Yeah, well, that's... how would you say that was
that's the anomaly.
Incompetence that led them to continue to suck for year after year. Like if they were drafting properly where they were getting an average number of players from the second round beyond, they wouldn't be in the hole for 10 years. You know, it was a combination of messing up most of their picks and... you know, everything, basically. So, that's like the one NHL historical mistake that, you know, exception to the rule. Normally, you know, if
you're
bad for 3 or 4 years...
You've seen some forward progress at some point.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, you'll go down to the bottom five, you'll draft the guy in the bottom five, and then you'll move forward because now you have the piece that you need. And that's...
Yeah, well, like if you look at the LA Kings... Right, the Kings, they sucked for a few years, like around the first lockout from like 2003 to 2005, 2006. They got better, and then they had a really bad year and ended up getting Drew Doughty, and then that was what ended up making them a two-time Stanley Cup champion. So,
yeah, well, that's it. There's a model laid out there. For a rebuild. We've seen teams do it. We've seen Chicago do it. We've seen LA do it. And that model generally requires you to fall into the top five at some point in the first couple of years.
Yeah. And we have once with Bennett, but if that happens again and we get another top five pick and say get Matthew Tkachuk, well, then that's a good addition. If not, you know, that's fine too, because we'll have rebounded and are doing a lot better. So, we'll see. Lots of hockey to go.
The other thing that a lot of fans are talking about early in the season is we've already seen a coach fired. We saw the Blue Jackets fire their coach Richards already and bring Tortorella in. There's been some notions out of Anaheim that they might be firing their coach. And there's been some fans that have questioned, should Bob Hartley, if the team can't get things back together, should Bob Hartley be relieved of his duties here? I'll start this out this time and say I think that firing Bob Hartley is the worst thing we can do for this team right now. Bob Hartley was brought in to rebuild the team, and that's exactly what we're doing. As we just said, there's ups and downs to a rebuild, but you don't take a guy who won a Jack Adams, who's kept most of that team together, and just say, well, we're not doing well. Get rid of the coach. Like we're exactly, I believe, still, we're where we expect to be. It's not like we're expecting to be running for the cup this year, realistically. Yes, anything can happen, but realistically, we're not expecting a run for the cup, and that's why Hartley was brought in. So I think at this point, firing Hartley would be the worst move these guys could make.
If the Flames struggle all season, and then next year at the end of October, they're in the same spot, then there might be a reason why you would fire him. Because the coaching staff will have plateaued with this particular group, and maybe you need to go in a different direction. But we're at least a year away from that. And that's if everything continues to screw up all season and it's a disastrous year, you still would need the start of next year to be equally disastrous in order to even consider it, in my opinion. Like, it's way, way, way too premature.
Yeah, I mean, you're not going to go and say, okay, let's say that we have the same result in November. You can't just go and fire Hartley for that. Like, Hartley was brought in for the rebuild. You have to let him stay. And especially the year after he went to Jack Adams, I don't think you can turf him.
No. And realistically, most of what's going on that the player's messing up, it's not like Chris Russell struggling in the defensive zone in a minus 16. Well, that's not Hartley's fault for him holding his stick, you know, and preventing him from making the correct defensive positioning things. You know, that's on Russell, and it just like it's on every other player. The system hasn't changed, so how the players are playing in that system has, and until the players sort it out, it's not 100% on the coaching staff.
There's no reason to be alarmist. There's no reason that we need to fire this coach. If changes need to be made, they need to be made inside the room. But as you said, Hartley's doing exactly what he needs to. He's got the same system. He's asking the same thing of these guys from last year. I don't think that's going to change anything.
No, and you can plainly see it's an execution problem, not... Like, I know some people have said that, like, other teams have adapted to the system, but the fact of the matter is that nobody's making passes properly or like even smart plays, like their positioning is not even correct. So wait until we see them actually start playing proper Flames hockey before.
So I think summing up both of our opinions on this, firing Hartley anytime this season is a mistake.
Yeah.
And I think, honestly, if they do that, it's not only a mistake, it's a mistake that will set the rebuild back.
Yeah, I agree. Because you've got people that are playing with an identity of never quit. And yes, it's messed up thus far, but it's hard to build an identity as an organization, as a team, as a philosophy. And the Flames did tap into that last year, and there was some cohesion that was atypical, and that's part of the reason why the Flames had that success. You don't just turf a guy because you played a dozen crappy games, just like you wouldn't turf him after the 8-game losing streak last year. Stuff happens. We've had pretty much every bad bounce that one team can have in the 12 games.
Things have to turn around.
Yeah. Even if you go on the advanced statistics for PDO, where the Flames were like the best team in the NHL last year and were due to regress, well, the Flames are on the exact opposite end, where they're getting like the worst luck in NHL history, according to that. Like, no team has finished below, like, 96, and, like, we're at, like, 93. So, that has to regress to the mean as well, and that means that the Flames will be better. It's just...
Well, and the thing, if you fire... Let's just assume that they did want to fire Bob Hartley. Just, you know, because so many fans have been saying this, my response has been, well, then who takes over? And I think at this point, you can't bring in another coach with a new system. You got to keep somebody who's going to keep the same basic Flames team going. If Hartley's out, I think Kluche leaves as well. Like, he's Hartley's right-hand man. He's not going to stick around without Bob. Jordan Sigla's not going to be your coach, which means Marty Jelena becomes the interim head coach, and I'm not comfortable at this point in his career for Jelly to take that role.
No, and like that's why like the whole thing doesn't make a lot of sense. Like, you wouldn't say go from Bob Hartley to a guy like Dave Tippett, not saying that Tippett's available, but, you know, like an extreme defensive coach, because, like, that'll just screw up everything.
Yeah.
So,
I just wanted to address it because some people had asked us to talk about it. It's something that's been out there in various forums and various places that were out there. So I just wanted to bring it up. I think it's
just be patient. You know, things will happen as they do.
As Flames fans, we want to see success right away, but it's a long season. We're 12 games into an 82-game season. Give it some time. Let things play out their way. Don't make any rash decisions like bringing up Gillies, firing the coach. We have the right roster. Let them do their job.
Yeah. And once the bad luck and like the weird bounces and the like really poor goaltending and bad defense starts getting corrected, this team will win games. Like, they're nowhere near as bad of a team as they have been this month. Will they make the playoffs? That's still up in the air. But, you know, you have to give it time. And it's November 2nd as we're recording this. Come back in January, February, March. Then we'll talk.
We'll be talking about it every week. But yeah, well, let's not,
you know,
let's
I mean.
Just leave it for now as don't make any rash changes.
Yeah, exactly.
We need to let this system, I don't even think January, February. I think we need to let this year play out all year. Even in January, I wouldn't want to make any changes like bringing Gillies up or getting rid of the coach. We have the roster we need. We have to run with it. We have the coaching staff. We have the goalies. Good or bad, this is the roster that our team has chosen to run with. And we have to let it play out the way it's going to. Yes, you'll make trades and that sort of thing, but we're not going to make wholesale changes in January.
No.
Well, all we can do is look forward to November, hope that we're going to get a better month. As you've mentioned, we had a lot of bounces that didn't go our way. We've had a lot of sort of fluky games. I wouldn't blame it all on that. I don't think anywhere near that. I think there's a lot of things that we have to say, you know what, the Flames didn't play well this month, but going forward, we are going to hope for better.
Yeah. Well, like, if you look at, like, if you counted for bad luck, the Flames record should probably be like 5 or 6 wins versus 3. That, you know, if they got proper luck and some, you know, like the strange, weird goals didn't happen, it would have been a lot, you know, not as drastically bad, but like, there was quite a few games where the Flames really did deserve to lose.
It's a good thing there's no Vegas team right now, because that's not a city you want to go into with bad luck.
No.
Well, Matt, looking at some of the bright side of what's going on in the organization then, you've been following the Stockton Heat quite closely. Why don't you give us an update of what's going on the farm?
They played 3 games this past week, and unfortunately, they dropped them all. The first game they lost 5-1. Gillies got pulled after 2 periods, giving up 5 goals on 25 shots. That was the game that Ramo played 20 minutes.
And how do you look?
It was just one of those games, and he struggled. Probably if he was on the top of his game, 2 of the goals he would have let in instead of 5. It happens. You know, any goaltender has a bad one. That was one of his. Then the next 2 were both against the San Diego Gulls on Friday and Saturday. And they dropped both of them 3-2. One in a shootout. One, they surrendered the game-winning goal with like 2 minutes left. In those games, the first one, the Stockton Heat should have easily won that game. Marcus Granlund himself missed, like, 4 great opportunities, 2 of which were, like, shots on a wide-open net that he just missed. So, you know, it's one of those things that some of that bad luck was going on down there, as well. And the one bright spot, I thought, in those two games was Oliver Shillington. He scored the second goal in the second game to temporarily give the Heat the lead. And his offense has been quite good. He has 3 points in 6 games with a pair of goals. And is actually second on Stockton in points, only trailing Kenny Agostino, who has 4 assists. And his defensive game in the first 5 games were kind of spotty at best. But in the last two, he was actually settling in quite well and played pretty good.
Overall, I mean, if you look at the Stockton Heat roster, they got a pretty good roster there. If you talk to Flames management, they've said that their goal with that team this year is to challenge for the Calder Cup. They want this team to be competitive. What do you think, based on the early season, do you think that the Heat have what it takes from what we've seen so far to make it to the playoffs?
It's one of those things where a lot of the things that were screwing up in Calgary have also been screwing up in Stockton. And a lot of the players that you would expect to be top performers, like Granlund, Poirier, Klimchuk, they're just not playing that well. And like, they're not playing like they should. And the only two guys that are really playing like they should are Agostino and Shillington. Everybody else is just kind of off in their timing. Passes aren't going where they should be. It's just not quite as fluid as they should be.
And you know, I think, and maybe it's not the whole thing, but there's a lot of new faces down there. And I think one of the things that we have to see from those guys is building chemistry. And once that happens, I think we'll probably see a lot better games and better timing. But there's a lot of these players that have never played together before, especially on the blue line.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. Like, Bill Arnold is having a fantastic season thus far. He's, put it this way, if the Flames didn't have as many forwards in the NHL as they do, he's NHL ready. And a lot of the players, just, it's a work in progress. I don't know if they'll make the playoffs. I don't know. I don't think they have enough talent to be a Calder Cup team, because usually the teams that vie for the Calder Cup are a lot more veteran-laden than
Stockton.
And that's
one thing we don't have, is we're a very young team, just as we were last year.
Yeah, like, it's pretty much Derek Grant is the only...
Who's not even there.
Yeah, he's the only, like, veteran offensive forward.
You've got a lot of AHL vets like Granlund, but we don't have a lot of NHL vets who've been demoted.
Yeah, like, if you look at, like, Utica from last year, the Canucks farm team, they were so successful because they had, like, 5 or 6 guys that were fringe NHL, AHL scorers, and where Adirondack struggled last year against them because we had all rookies and young guys.
Well, keep us updated on the Heat as we go forward. It'll be interesting to see if they can get things together. They haven't played many games, and they play mostly a weekend schedule down there, so they don't play as many games as we do up here often in a week to, you know, get the legs moving and get these guys
playing
together.
Yeah, well, for comparison, they've only actually played 6 games where the Flames have played 12.
There you go. So they played half the number of games. So it's,
yeah, they're 2-3-1.
So it's expected that there's going to be some growing pains there, and they're just not playing as much as we are to be able to work through that.
Yeah, exactly.
On the prospect front, looking at some of the guys who aren't playing professional hockey right now, Rasmus Anderson had a good week this week. He was the Flames' first-round selection this year, or the Flames' second-round pick this year, one of their
first selection, second round.
I keep thinking he was the first-round pick, but we don't have a first-round pick this year. He plays defense for the Barrie Colts of the OHL. He had 3 points this week, which puts him in 13 games at 10 points, and he's sitting at a -6. But, you know, 10 points for a defenseman this early, not too bad.
Yeah.
A guy that we continue to see good things from, and we talked about him last time as well, as Andrew Mangiapane. He was a late pick for the Flames. He was a sixth round pick, but he leads the Barrie Colts. He plays for the same team as Rasmus Anderson and is fourth in the OHL scoring race. He has 23 points in 15 games, 11 goals and 12 assists. You know, anytime we see a sixth round pick scoring better than point per game in a tough league like the OHL, and 15 games in, I mean, you can start to see a guy hitting his stride at that point. That's impressive. That's good scouting by the Flames.
Yeah, and it's one of those things with a player like that. If he doesn't necessarily make the NHL, at least he'll be a quality player for the Stockton Heat or wherever the Flames AHL affiliate is in the future to allow and facilitate the other guys that are down there, their development. So even if he doesn't turn out, at least he's a good foil for the other guys.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at Monjapan's numbers, in his first year in the OHL, 2013-2014 for Barrie, he had 51 goals in 68 games. Last year, he had 104 points in 68 games. And this year, he's so far got 23 points in 15 games. So for a guy who's as big a scorer as he is, like to have 104-point career, it's surprising that he fell to the sixth round.
It was his height. That's pretty much the only reason.
Yeah, because he's only 5'10".
Yeah. If he was 6'1", he's probably a second round pick.
So, but good to see that, because you need those late round picks to produce for you. And as we've talked about, the Flames have had a lot of late round picks lately that have been producing for them.
Well, exactly. No team can get by with just their first round pick coming through. You need to have guys like TJ Brody, Johnny Gaudreau, those type of guys, even Josh Juris, who's a walk-on free agent, or Mark Giordano. You need those guys that you don't get through just first round picks.
Somebody's got to round out the team. You can't play, four lines of first round picks.
Yeah, well, that's why the Edmonton Oilers have struggled, because they haven't been getting any second, third, fourth, fifth, or sixth, seventh round picks to actually make the NHL outside of Jeff Petrie in the last 10 years. So, that's why they're having a hard time filling out their roster, because they're just throwing in the Halls, the Nugent Hopkins, the Eberleys, and that's it. And you need more depth than that.
Continuing down, looking at some of the prospects, the one who's closest to home, I imagine some of our listeners have seen him already, is Pavel Karnikov, who's a centerman for the Hitmen. He's had a pair of goals and 5 points in 9 outings, so he has 2 goals, 3 assists for 5 points in 9 games, but he got sidelined recently. He has an upper body injury, that's all we know, and he's considered week to week. So Karnikov is a guy, I think, this year who just has to play, and seeing that he is going to be out week to week, that I think might, depend on how long he's out, might hinder him. Could set him back quite a bit this year, I think.
Yeah, it's one of those things that you want all your players to play, and whether they progress or not is really up to them. You take your best shots with who you draft, and you hope for the best.
I think Karnikov has potential, but I think that he's one of these guys who is going to need to play to get his skills to where they need to be. And I think just having him out, I mean, week to week is generally not a bad thing, but it depends how long he's out. If he misses significant time, I think it might set him back a bit.
Yeah.
But the last guy that I'll point out here, not a lot of other stellar news, but the guy that I think is probably going to be the next big Flame, not big in terms of his physical size, but big in terms of where he was drafted, who will turn pro, is Mark Jankowski. He's still playing for Providence College of Hockey East. In 7 games, he has 3 goals and 7 assists, 10 points for Providence. Again, anytime you can do better than point per game, even at the college level, good to see from Jankowski. He's a late developer, but based on what we saw at training camp this summer, I'm excited about seeing what he's going to do this year as he transitions into a pro game.
Yeah, if he was not in the NCAA and he was playing in Stockton currently, he probably would have got a call-up at some point this season just because of his size and his pedigree and his overall play. And the fact that he's one of the league leaders in the NCAA in points is a good sign. He seemed to turn the corner about halfway through last season and hasn't really looked back. And if he can actually turn into a quality NHL player, that's awesome. Because anytime you get a 6'3", 6'4" center that wins a lot of faceoffs, that'll help.
He's 6'3", but he's only 175 pounds, and
he's 200 now.
Oh, is he now 200? Okay. Even then, though, he's going to be a little bit on the skinny side, so I think he's still going to have to put on some weight before he jumps to being a pro next year.
Yeah, well, he'll probably still take 2 or 3 years to get up to the 220, 230 range, but... You know, like even Joel Colborne, it took him a while to pack on the weight as well. It wasn't until this season that he got up to his full size weight. So yeah, the fact that Janko's only 200, 205, it's not a big deal.
If we look at Jankowski in the past, playing for Providence College and sort of his numbers and where he's at now. In 2012-2013, he played 34 games and he had 18 points. In 2013-2014, he played 39 games and had 25 points. Last year, he played 37 games at 27 points. And this year, he has 10 points in 7 games. So, I mean, if he keeps going on that pace, he's probably going to have a 50-60-point season.
Yeah, realistically, anything over like 35 to 40 points, it will be a great year for him. I'm just hoping that he continues to be consistent all season instead of like just a flash in the pan early. But, yeah. Either way, I'm looking forward to seeing him play next year, both at the July development camp and in the actual NHL training camp, and see where he goes. I think that he will be in the NHL to start next season with the Flames.
The nice thing is that we've, because of the way the Flames have drafted over the last couple of years, we've had the time to develop him. He was a long-term project when he got developed, and I think it's nice that we've had other guys like Goudreau, like Bennett, you know, even guys like Juris, who have sort of filled that role, and we haven't had to rush him ahead, and it's allowed him to sort of be a little bit more obscure. Fans aren't following him as much as they were when he first got drafted because he was the first round pick. And I think it's let him sort of develop in peace, and we'll see him when he's ready.
Yeah, well, back when Jay Feaster drafted him, like when he was being interviewed following the pick, he said, this is a player that's going to be 4 or 5 years away. Well, we're 3 years away from that pick, and yeah, that's about right.
Yeah. But I mean, the fact he's not playing in the, you know, in the WHL or in Canada, I think it's let him sort of be obscure to Flames fans too, and I think that's probably good for him at this point because he doesn't need a lot more pressure on him.
No, and the fact that he's in the NCAA gives him more time in the weight room to bulk up,
yeah,
so it's all good.
He's 21, so probably 22, 23 by the time he makes the team, so he'll be a bit of an older guy. But sometimes those NCAA guys come with a bit more experience. And we've seen the Flames have really good success with college players over the last couple of years.
Yeah, and I expect him fully to be able to step right into the NHL next year. So we'll see.
Well, Matt, I think that's all the Flames news this week. So why don't we play our weekly prediction game?
Okay. We got three games on the schedule this week, right?
Three games, 6 points. You and I finally figured some things out about the way we want to score points for this year. So we're going to do two separate sets of points. We're going to give 1 point if somebody gets the correct number of points per week. So if we think, say, you'll get one win, and you do get one win, you get 1 point. If you get both the team and the points, you get 2 points for that one. So sort of like the NHL, where you can get 1 point for tying, 2 points for a win. So we're going to make it a little bit more competitive that way this year. So far, you're the only one coming into this past week that had any points. In the first week of the season, you got 2 points for getting the right number of games and the team. This past week, we had 6 points possible. I thought we'd get 2 points by beating Montreal. You thought we'd get 2 points by beating Ottawa. We beat neither. We won the other game. We got 2 points, but we did against Edmonton. So,
and we also got the shootout point, so we ended up being incorrect entirely.
You're right. You thought we'd beat Ottawa. You were right, but you thought we'd get 2 points against Ottawa.
Yeah, no.
So
it was 3 points in total. We both thought two, so...
So you ended up with you ended up with 1 point?
No, we didn't.
Oh no, you're right. You ended up
got a donut, the pair of us.
You're right. So yeah, I got because we both thought that we would get 2 points. And
but
you're right,
we got three.
So we got a donut.
Yeah.
So you're still up 2 points and I still have none for the season. Unfortunately, I won last year, so I gotta get back into this. So coming into this week, then, we have 6 possible points on the table, 3 games. One of them is on the road, and 2 of them are at home. The first game of the week, we have Ramo and net as the Flames travel to Colorado to take on Jerome McGinley and the Colorado Avalanche. Then we have a home game against the Philadelphia Flyers, and Saturday night, Sidney Crosby and the Pens come to town. Predictions for this week, Matt?
3 games, 6 points.
You think we're going to win all 3?
Yep. I think that Frolik goal snapped the Flames out of their fun run. I think with Colorado struggling as badly as they have, that the Flames will still be iffy, but will get the 2 points. Then they'll start getting on a roll against Philadelphia, and then finally beating Pittsburgh.
Sure, optimistic this week.
Yep.
I'm not going to do 6. I'm going to say 4 games. I think that we've got the momentum we need to beat Jerome McGinley and his Avalanche. I think with the start we're seeing in Philadelphia, I think we can beat the Flyers, but I'm not confident. We always struggle against the Pens, and I think that that's going to continue. So I'm going to go 4 games, Colorado and the Flyers.
Okay. Works for me.
So we'll see what happens.
At least we're not agreeing on like the amount of points like we have the last couple weeks.
Yeah, we've been pretty good so far. Only 1 week we've agreed.
Yeah.
But I'm hoping you're right. I'm hoping I'm wrong this week because I'd love to see a sweep because we need the points at this point. But I don't know.
Yeah, no, that was the one I was iffy on, but I'm like, let's go all the way and be completely optimistic.
I shouldn't say this, but I hope I lose this week and that we get all 6. I don't hope I lose this week because we get less than 4, but I hope I lose to you this week and you get the points for getting all 6 points because we need the points. But I'm just not convinced, just as I wasn't convinced we beat the Blue Shirts. The other big Eastern Conference team we struggle against is the Pens, and I have a feeling they're going to light us up.
Yeah.
I don't even think it's going to be a pretty loss. I think it's going to be like the Montreal, like a 6-2 somewhere in there.
Well, we'll see. Hopefully the Flames can start getting on a roll.
Yeah, hopefully. And if they can, even take, I think, even 4 points this week makes for a good start to the month.
Oh, yeah, that's a positive because at least, okay, we're getting our foot walking in the right direction instead of, what this whole month's been, so...
So let's hope that at least one of us is right, because if neither one of us is right, it means that the team has failed terribly.
Or we got 5 points and split the difference.
That's true. That would not be bad either.
No.
The last thing I want to let fans know about this week is the new Fireside Chat website, as you guys know, is up. It's been up for a couple weeks now. We have some new ways that we want to interact with you guys. We have a great new tool on the site that allows you to join the conversation on the podcast. So if there's something you want to know about, if there's questions you have about the team, if there's anything that you want us to talk about, or you want to give us your feedback, maybe you think Bob Hartley needs to be fired and you have a convincing reason as to why, join the conversation. You can find 2 ways to get a hold of us. If you go to the website and you'll see in the main menu at the top under podcasts, you can roll your mouse over podcast and go to join the conversation. You'll go to a page where you can either send us an email or you can leave us a voicemail. You can actually use your computer's mic to leave us a message and that'll come right to us. And if we can play it on the show, we will. Try to record that if you can in a quiet environment if you're using your built-in mic, because often the mics that are built into laptops and stuff aren't very good. Or do it on your phone because your phone's obviously got a good microphone. The other place you can find the same voicemail page is on the right-hand side of any page in the website. You'll see a red tab that says Join the Conversation. If you click on that, it'll prompt you to record a message for us. And hopefully we'll get some feedback from you guys that we can put into the show. Matt, I think that's about it for this week. Let's hope for at least 4 points in the week.
Yeah.
And I think I'm optimistic about November.
Yeah, I think we'll have a good bounce back. I think at least 8 wins this month.
Really? 8 wins?
8 out of 12.
Wow. You're optimistic.
Yeah.
So we need 6 to play 500.
We need at least 7 or 8. So.
We need at least 6 to play 500 hockey this month. We need 7, I think, probably to get back in the hunt, just kind of looking at where we're at.
Yeah. Probably 15 to 18 points at least to get back into the swing of things.
Yeah, we can't afford another month like October.
If we do, then, you know, it's curtains on the season.
Yep. Well, let's see how it goes, and I'll talk to you next week, man.
Yeah, take care, and thanks for listening, everyone. Have a good week.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.